Hey everyone, my name is Brian. After many years of building with Angular, I'm here to help you level up your skills and build better apps. You know what's worse than accidentally clicking a button twice? Clicking it 10 times and realizing it worked every time. Well, in this video, we're building a reusable cooldown button in Angular. One that disables itself for a few seconds after each click using a signal and setInterval. You'll see how to progressively enhance a plain button into a self-managing UI component you can drop into real-world forms step-by-step with modern Angular best practices. This is perfect for feedback forms, one-time password forms, or anytime you want a button to chill out for a few seconds after being clicked. Okay, let's get started. Here's the simple application that we'll be working with. It's just a basic message form. When you type a message, you can then submit the form. And when you do, a success message displays for a second. What we want to do is give this button a brain. We want to prevent users from rapidly resubmitting this form quickly. We need to disable it for a few seconds after they submit it, and we want to show them how long they need to wait before they can submit again. Let's look at some code to better understand what we're working with. First, let's look at the form component. Okay, here's our button. It's a custom cooldown button component with a disabled input and a click event that calls an onSubmit function. Pretty simple, right? Now, let's look at the template for this button component. Okay, right now it's super basic. Just has a click event where we call a handleClick method and a disabled attribute bound to the disabled input. Now let's look at the TypeScript. Okay, this too is super simple. We just have the disabled input and the empty handleClick method. So let's make this better. Let's add some logic for this button to disable itself and show a countdown for a few seconds after it's clicked. First, let's add a new property called cooldown seconds. This will be a signal with an initial value of 0. This creates a reactive value that will update every second during cooldown. Next, we need to add another property called interval ID. This will be used to clear our counter. We'll be using setInterval, and when doing so, the browser returns a number that acts like a unique ticket, kind of like a timer receipt. We can use that number later to clear the interval and cancel the ticking when needed. Next, let's add one more property for the duration. This too will be a signal. And let's give it an initial value of 6. So the default countdown will occur over 6 seconds. Okay, now let's add the cooldown logic. In our handleClick function here, let's add a variable to track the end of the timer in terms of seconds. We'll use the current time and we'll add the duration, multiplied by 1000 since we're dealing with milliseconds and we want to display seconds. Okay, now we want to make sure we clear any existing running intervals, so we'll use the clearInterval function and we'll pass it our interval ID. This will cancel any interval that matches this ID. Now we're ready to add our interval. When using the setInterval function, it returns a positive integer to uniquely identify the timer, so let's use our interval ID property to store this ID. Okay, so this timer is going to run every second until we clear it. So within it, let's add a variable for the remaining time left in our counter. We'll use math.seal to make sure that we always round up to the nearest second. Then we'll use our end variable to subtract the current time, and then we'll divide by 1000. So this will store the total seconds remaining in our counter. Now we can update our cooldown second signal. For this, we'll use the mathmax function to make sure that we don't end up with a negative number of seconds by using 0 along with our remaining count. This will always take the larger of the two numbers. It just prevents issues in case the timer overshoots slightly. Now, we can check to see if our remaining duration is less than or equal to 0. If so, we can clear the interval. This will kill the timer when we reach the end of our countdown. Okay, now the last part here is to make sure the interval is cleared when the component is destroyed. So let's implement the onDestroy interface. Then we can add the onDestroyed method and clear the interval. This just ensures that we don't leave any timers running after the component is gone. Okay, that should be everything we need here. Now let's reflect that state in the UI. Let's update this label. Let's add a condition to check if the cooldown seconds value is greater than 0. If it is, let's add a message that displays our live countdown in seconds as it's running. I love that we can use template strings like this for concatenation in the template now too. And then we'll move the send label to the else. Okay. I think that's everything now, so let's save and see how this all works. Now, when we submit, we have a countdown. Nice. That's pretty cool, huh? It's a nice way to slow the user down, but provide feedback so they understand what's going on. The one thing that's strange here, though, is that there is a portion here where the button is still counting down, but enabled. See that portion there? Let's fix this. Let's make sure the button is disabled when it's in cooldown mode, no matter what. To do this, let's add to our current disabled binding to also disable when the countdown seconds is greater than 0. Okay, that should do it. Let's save and try this out again now. Let's add a message and save. There. Now it stays disabled the entire time the countdown runs. So this is working pretty well now, but since it's reusable, we may want to change the label, huh? What if we wanted this button to say send message instead of send? Well, we can't do this currently. So what we should do is add an input. Let's open back up the TypeScript. Now let's add a new label input, and we can provide a fallback value of send. So if we don't pass a custom label, it'll still display send like it currently does. Okay, now we can just switch back to the template. Here, we can replace the old static label with the string interpolated value of our new input. Okay, now we just need to pass our custom value in the form component. So we just add the label input and then give it a value of send message. Okay, now let's save and check it out. There, now we have a custom label. I think that's a good addition to this component because it can be used for pretty much anything. Now, what about the duration? What if we want to configure the duration? Like, what if we wanted this particular button to count down from 8 seconds instead of 6? Well, let's switch our current duration signal to another input. We'll also make it required this time, which means we'll have to add a duration every time we use this component now. Okay, now we can switch back to the form. Here, let's add the new duration input and give it a value of 8 seconds. Okay, that's all we need for this. So let's save and see how it works now. Let's add a message again and send. Okay, now it takes a little longer, right? Pretty neat, huh? So, we started with a simple button and ended up with a self-managing, cooldown-powered Angular component. It disables itself after use, it gives real-time feedback using signals, and it plays nicely in any form. This pattern is clean, modern, and doesn't require extra dependencies or services, just Angular, the way it's meant to be used. Got ideas for other reusable components like this? Drop them in the comments. I'd love to hear what you're building. If this helped you out, be sure to give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and check out some of my other tutorials to keep the learning going. Until next time, thanks for watching.